of clinical rounds in comprehensive ophthalmology. I am Dr. Santosh Bhide, and with me is Dr. Niladri Saha from Calcutta, Malda. And we will have a very interesting session of comprehensive ophthalmology. Do we have Dr. Jaswant Arneja? Dr. Jaswant is there. Dr. Indu Arneja. Dr. Jatinder Singh Bhalla. Dr. Manilal Chauthalia, Biraj Goswami, Dr. Abha Kanade. Can we start with your presentation, please, madam? Dr. Abha Kanade is a senior ophthalmologist from Pune. She has a specialization in squint, and she is going to talk on monocular elevation deficit. Dr. Abha Kanade, please.
मैं चेयरमैन साइंटिफिक कमेटी प्रोफेसर ललित वर्मा साहब की बहुत आभारी हूँ कि जिन्होंने मुझे मोनोक्युलर एलिवेशन डेफिसिट पर बोलने के लिए मैं उनकी आभारी हूँ. मोनोक्युलर एलिवेशन डेफिसिट को हम इस हेडिंग्स के अंडर बात करेंगे, मतलब इसकी परिभाषा क्या है, उसके लक्षण क्या है, उसकी इटियोलॉजी क्या है, उसको कैसे मैनेज करेंगे, उसके कॉम्प्लिकेशंस क्या हैं, और हम कुछ केसेस के बारे में भी बात करेंगे. एज़ फार एज़ द डेफिनेशन इज़ कंसर्न, ये यूनिलैटरल डेफिसिट ऑफ एलिवेशन है विच इज़ एसोसिएटेड विथ वेरिएबल अमाउंट ऑफ टोसिस. हमें मालूम है कि थर्ड नर्व जो है उसके दो डिविजन्स होते हैं, सुपीरियर डिविजन एंड इन्फीरियर डिविजन. इन सुपीरियर डिविजन सुपीरियर एक्टस और लिवेटर पैल्पेब्रा सुपीरियरिस को सप्लाई करता है, और जिसकी वजह से ये मोस्ट ऑफ द टाइम मोनोक्युलर एलिवेशन डेफिसिट होता है. इसके अगर लक्षणों के बारे में अगर हम बात करें तो इसमें एबनॉर्मल हेड पोस्चर हो सकता है या नहीं भी हो सकता है. इसमें टोसिस हो सकता है, मोस्ट ऑफ द टाइम इट मे बी ट्रू स्यूडो और मिक्स्ड. एलिवेशन डेफिसिट, इसकी खासियत है कि एलिवेशन डेफिसिट जो है ये एबडक्शन में भी हो सकता, एबडक्शन में होता है, प्राइमरी पोजिशन में भी होता है, और एडक्शन में भी होता है. एंड हमें इसके व्हेन वी सी द पेशेंट बेल्स फिनोमेना और फोर्स डिक्शन टेस्ट करना बहुत ज़रूरी है. अब जैसे हमने बोला था कि एबनॉर्मल हेड पोस्चर पेशेंट में होता है, फॉर एग्जांपल ये इस पेशेंट में पार्शियल टोसिस है और पार्शियल एलिवेशन डेफिसिट है, तो ये एबनॉर्मल हेड पोस्चर मतलब चिन एलिवेशन को करके ही कैन मैनेज. बट इफ़ यू सी दिस पेशेंट इसमें कंप्लीट टोसिस है, तो इस पेशेंट में एबनॉर्मल हेड पोस्चर को अडाप्ट नहीं करेगा. एज फार एज द लिमिटेशन ऑफ एलिवेशन को अगर आप देखें तो ये आप देखेंगे कि एबडक्शन में भी एलिवेशन डेफिसिट है, प्राइमरी पोजिशन में भी है, और एडक्शन में भी है. जैसे हमने टोसिस के बारे में बात किया था, तो टोसिस ट्रू भी हो सकता है, स्यूडो भी हो सकता है, या मिक्स्ड भी हो सकता है. अब ट्रू टोसिस कैसे पहचानेंगे, जो नॉर्मल आय है उसके सामने अगर आप ऑक्लूजन लगाएंगे तो देर विल बी नो इफेक्ट ऑन द टोसिस. पर अगर स्यूडोटोसिस है तो जो नॉर्मल आँख के सामने आप ऑक्लूजन लगाएंगे यू विल सी दैट देयर इज कंप्लीट एलिवेशन ऑफ द आईलिड, सो इट इज़ अ स्यूडोटोसिस. इसके जो कारणों के बारे में अगर बता करें तो कॉन्जिनिटल या एक्वायर्ड दोनों हो सकता है. वी विल नॉट गो इनटू द डिटेल्स क्योंकि ये कॉम्प्रिहेंसिव वाला है. तो मोस्ट ऑफ द टाइम जो 50% पेशेंट्स होते हैं कि जिनमें प्राइमरी पोजिशन में हाइपोट्रोपिया होता है उसमें सुपीरियर रेक्टस पैरेसिस की वजह से ज़्यादा होता है, और जो प्राइमरी इन्फीरियर रेक्टस रिस्ट्रिक्शन है उसमें एफडीटी हमेशा पॉजिटिव रहेगी, और देयर मे बी एब्सेंस ऑफ हाइपो इन द प्राइमरी गेज. अब इसलिए जो है एलिवेशन डेफिसिट, ये सुप्रानिकुलर भी हो सकता है, इंफ्रानिकुलर भी हो सकता है. सुप्रानिकुलर में बेल्स फिनोमिना इज प्रेजेंट और इंफ्रानिकुलर में बेल्स फिनोमिना एब्सेंट होता है. अब ये देखिए, ये बेल्स फिनोमिना है, ये प्रोटेक्टिव फिनोमिना है. सो ऑन फोर्सफुल फुल क्लोजर ऑफ द आईबॉल यू विल सी दैट देर इज एलिवेशन बट विच इज एब्सेंट इन द राइट हैंड. बहुत बार इन्फीरियर एक्टस रिस्ट्रिक्शन की वजह से भी हो सकता है. ये कॉन्जेनिटल पेशेंट है, इसको एक्चुअली प्राइमरी पोजीशन में कोई डेविएशन नहीं था, बट यू सी व्हेन द पेशेंट लुक्स अप उसमें लोअर लिड में आपको एक क्रीज नज़र आता है. सो इट इज़ मेनली बिकॉज ऑफ द इन्फीरियर एक्टस कॉन्ट्रैक्चर्स रिस्ट्रिक्शन. और इसमें देखिए आप, जब पेशेंट ऊपर देखता है तो यू कैन सी द क्रीज. सो the goal is if there is no deviation in the primary position aap usko observe kar sakte hain, but if there is a deviation in the primary position, complete ptosis hai to hame isko treat karna chahiye to improve the eye position in the primary base aur hame amblyopia prevent karne. These are different surgical options. Agar hum dekhe to main force reduction test pe bahut sari cheeze depend karti hain ki surgical option kaun sa karna hai. If the force reduction test is positive, that means you have to do recess and resect of the superior rectus and inferior rectus, recession resection procedure. Par agar force reduction test negative hai to you can do modified DAPS procedure. This is showing diagrammatic representation है NAPS procedure का with various variations in the tendon placement. इसमें हमने थोड़ा oblique रखा है, इसमें it is concentric with the limbus और दूसरा जो है ये modified है. इसमें हम superior rectus के जो fibers है उसके parallel horizontal muscle का placement किया है. ये एक्चुअली इसमें फोर्स रिडक्शन टेस्ट बहुत अच्छे से नहीं आई है, लेकिन ये देखिए इन मीडियल और लैटरल रेक्टस को हमने सुपीरियर रेक्टस के साइड में उसको अटैच कर दिया है. टेंडन, फुल टेंडन ट्रांसपोजिशन है ये. अगेन दिस इज मीडियल और लैटरल रेक्टस का ट्रांसपोजिशन है सुपीरियर रेक्टस के साइड में. यू कैन सी द सुपीरियर रेक्टस मसल एंड दिस इज पैरेलल टू दिस सुपीरियर एक्टर्स के फाइबर्स के. ये जो है इसमें इसमें फोर्स रिडक्शन टेस्ट पॉजिटिव था. यू कैन सी दैट देयर इज शोइंग कॉन्ट्रैक्चर्स ऑफ द मतलब थोड़ा सा कंजंक्टिवा के नीचे से भी यू कैन सी थिक इन्फीरियर एक्टर्स मसल. तो इसमें हमने पहले इन्फीरियर एक्टर्स का रिसेशन किया है बाय हैंगबैक टेक्निक और उसके बाद में जो मीडियल और लैटरल एक्टर्स हैं उनको कॉन्सेंट्रिक विद द लिम्बस हमने उसको अटैच कर दिया है. आई विल शो सम ऑफ द केसेस. इसमें देखिए प्राइमरी पोजीशन में हाइपो है विच इज प्रेजेंट इन एबडक्शन इन प्राइमरी पोजीशन एंड ऑल्सो इन एलिवेशन इन एडक्शन. दिस इज पोस्ट ऑप. एक्चुअली इसके बाद में देर वर टोसिस उसमें था प्रेजेंट. सो पेशेंट वॉज टेकन फॉर टोसिस सर्जरी एंड देन आई रियलाइज ही इज द सेम पेशेंट एंड इट वॉज नॉट डन बाई मी बट इन द सेकेंड ओ टी इट वॉज गोइंग ऑन. सो आई जस्ट वॉन्टेड टू डिमॉन्स्ट्रेट द एलिवेशन पोस्ट ऑप एलिवेशन आफ्टर द मैप्स प्रोसीजर. एक मिनट, जस्ट अ मिनट. So you can see there is quite a good amount of elevation. This is a NAPS procedure where the force reduction test was negative. So this is pre-op and this is post-op. And you can see this patient again after NAPS procedure. You can see the elevation very nicely. This was a I think it's a unique case. I don't know whether this was first type I have seen. In one eye, the patient had monocular elevation deficit, or दूसरी आँख में इसको advanced type 1 retraction syndrome है. You can see elevation deficit है इसमें, और sorry, there is abduction deficit in the left eye and elevation in the right eye. And left eye में उसको you can see the upshoot, which is sometimes typical of the advanced retraction syndrome. मैंने प्रोफेसर प्रदीप शर्मा सर से बात की थी, तो ही सेड कि दिस पेशेंट कम्स अंडर सीसीडीडी मींस बोथ हैज ही हैड कॉन्जेनिटल क्रेनियल डिसइनर्वेशनल डिसऑर्डर्स. सो इसमें हमने लेफ्ट आई में लैटरल रेक्टस और मीडियल रेक्टस का रिसेशन किया था और राइट आई में इन्फीरियर रेक्टस रिसेशन और नैप्स प्रोसीजर किया था. सो यू कैन सी दिस वॉज प्री ऑप. यू हैव सीन दैट देर इज अपशूट और इसमें इसका अपशूट एब्सेंट हो गया आफ्टर द सर्जरी. इस पेशेंट में फोर्स डक्शन टेस्ट निगेटिव था तो इसलिए हमने इसको सिर्फ पहले सॉरी नैप्स प्रोसीजर किया बट सी दिस वॉज प्री ऑप पेशेंट प्री ऑप इसमें सिर्फ नैप्स किया था बट आफ्टर सर्जरी देयर वॉज अगेन देयर वॉज अ रेसिड्यूअल एलिवेशन डेफिसिट. उसके बाद में इसको हमने इन्फीरियर रेक्टस रिसेशन किया तो इट वॉज इट गेव अ वेरी गुड रिजल्ट्स एंड आई रियली डोंट नो व्हेन वी ट्रांसपोज द होल टेंडन ट्रांसपोजिशन इन द अब्गेस एडक्शन एंड अबडक्शन इज नॉट लिमिटेड. आई डोंट नो व्हाट इज द कॉज. You can see that abduction, adduction, and it was just before the ptosis surgery. I think this video is not working. So complications is mein hai, under correction ho sakta hai, over corrections ho sakta hai, but I have never seen over corrections. So changes in the lower lead bhi ho sakta hai, but whenever we are tackling in the tight inferior rectus muscle, be careful while dissecting the muscle or anterior segment ischemia adult mein hone ke chances hai when you are operating three recta at a time but it is not so in the child. Bahut bar patient ko diplopia ho sakta hai reading position mein so you can do a recess you can do a recession of the contralateral superior rectus. Ye केस को मैं मेंशन करना चाहूँगी. एक्चुअली द टॉपिक इज इन्फीरियर मोनोक्युलर एलिवेशन डेफिसिट बट दिस पेशेंट हैड बायनोक्युलर एलिवेशन डेफिसिट. द पेशेंट हैड अ वेरी एबनॉर्मल चिन एलिवेशन पोजीशन एंड यू कैन सी व्हेन द इन द प्राइमरी पोजीशन शी हैज़ टू स्ट्रगल टू एलिवेट द आईबॉल्स. सो दिस पेशेंट अंडरवेंट फोर्स रिडक्शन टेस्ट. इट वॉज स्ट्रांगली पॉजिटिव बट इन्फीरियर रेक्टस वॉज एट इट्स साइट एंड देयर वॉज अ वेरी स्ट्रांग attachment just behind the insertion of the inferior rectus muscle and we cut it and after that I don't know sometimes the feeling for cutting that band was just like as if we are cutting the optic nerve. So the patient was under local anesthesia. We asked after cutting that can she see. Yeah, she said she can see. So in the second stage we did the in the other eye also she had the same fibrous band in the same type of band in the other eye also. So carry home message. Most of the time patient doesn't know that he has elevation deficit. So patient comes with abnormality of lid ki aankh khulti nahi hai, abnormal head posture hai. To explain karna chahiye ki usko pehle hum elevation deficit correct karenge aur uske baad mein hame ptosis karna pad sakta hai. और एक हमें ध्यान रखना चाहिए कि देयर आर अटैचमेंट्स ऑफ इन्फीरियर रेक्टस विद द लोअर लीड. सो एक्साइज दीज अटैचमेंट्स कम्प्लीटली टू प्रिवेंट द पोस्ट ऑफ लीड एबनॉर्मलिटी. सो ये भी है और ये मैंने अपनी तरफ से अपने आप को कमिट किया है. यस जस्ट वन स्लाइड. दिस इज फॉर सेव नेचर. दिस इज फ्रॉम द बुक मराठी बुक बखर पर्यावरणाची बाय अतुल देऊळगावकर. ये जो मंसर हमारा डिस्ट्रिक्ट है वहाँ पे जो वन विभाग है फॉरेस्ट वहाँ पे लगाया हुआ है. आई विल जस्ट रीड दिस. 10,000 क्यूबिक मीटर ऑफ वाटर से आप क्या क्या कर सकते हैं एंड वन क्यूबिक मीटर वाटर इज इक्वल टू 1,000 लीटर्स. वन कैन ग्रो राइस इन वन एकर कैन ग्रो व्हीट इन थ्री एकर्स. दिस कैन प्रोवाइड वाटर फॉर 3 years टू 100 आदिवासी फैमिलीज एंड देयर 400 कैटल्स और 100 अर्बन फैमिलीज कैन यूज दिस वाटर फॉर 2 years. बट द सेम अमाउंट ऑफ वाटर इज यूज बाई 100 फैमिलीज इन 55 डेज इन 5-star होटल्स. थैंक यू सर. थैंक यू सर.
थैंक यू वेरी मच डॉक्टर आभा कनाडे फॉर योर नाइस प्रेजेंटेशन. कैन आई आस्क डॉक्टर बिराज ज्योति गोस्वामी बिराज दा. ही इज अ senior ophthalmologist and other than he is also a fantastic singer both. I think last slide he will sing a little bit.
Yeah, sure. Thank you for your kind words. Vijay Goswami. A good afternoon to all of you on the dais and off the dais. I'm wondering why this Sunday academic session should be there. If it is not relevant because the hall attendance show that it is not attractive, then rather we should go for an extended session on Saturday and stop this Sunday. Anyway, we have to complete our assignments, and my assignment is here talking on a surgery which most of the ophthalmologists keep sighing off because of lot of factors, mainly because of mental block, and that too in a condition, special condition, where there are a lot of scar prone situations and it becomes more perplexed. Since Toti first described the external dacrocystorhinostomy in 1904, by now 110 years of refinement has made this procedure one of the most predictable and successful procedure, but failure looms in the horizon. It varies from 10% to 28%, as the literature says, but my personal experience is success rate is 98.6%. Failure is generally defined as anatomical and symptomatic, and it is due to mainly three factors. One is obstruction in the common canalicular end, granulation tissue or fibrous tissue growth in the flap anastomosis, and closure of the osteotomy site. And the prognosis goes downhill when there are in certain conditions due to exuberance of fibrosis and tissue growth. These are the conditions where there is exuberance, repeated acute dacrocystitis, lacrimal abscess with fistula, non-organic obstruction, previously failed DCR, and post-irradiation and post-traumatic cases. Paraoperatively also, if we get an anterior placed ethmoidal cells, contracture of the lacrimal sac, and excessive scarring or bleeding may lead to failure. I mean, they may be the important causes of failure. In one of my previous publications, we have noted in a series of revision this year, the commonest cause to be an anastomotic closure, and then closure of osteotomy, and then canalicular obstruction. The principles outline of these cases are microscopic precision. I always keep on telling that it is the microscope that allows us to see and cut rather than guess and cut. So we should always use a microscope while doing this year. That removes a lot of problems. We have to make a large bony ostea. My preference is to make 14 by 10 or more than that. We curate the ostium margin thoroughly to reduce the osteophytic activity of the ostium margin. Then we, after making the flaps, we may anchor the anterior flaps to the undersurface of the medial palpebral ligament and to the periosteum, thus to prevent the SAM syndrome. And while suturing, we have to keep the probe so that we do not suture the canaliculars by accident. And during the surgery, we have to excise completely the fistula or scar. And if there is an anterior ethmoidal cell, we have to remove it thoroughly. Preoperatively, we have to take the care of the nasal pathology if there is any, and we have to decongest, which should be continued for the postoperative period also. There are procedures adjuvant to the success, elastic stent and antimetabolites. I will be talking about antimetabolites, that is mitomycin C, which has been used for trabeculectomy and pterygium surgery for a long time, and also in this year there are small studies. So we went for a prospective study to see the role of the mitomycin C in 425 patients with those identified criteria, what I have already mentioned, in 350 using mitomycin and 75 without. This was a prospective open label study almost for 20 years because there are a lot of exclusion criteria. So number is 425. We are very stringent about the number. Particularly when we are doing a normal this year only with scar or implanted cellastic tube or any sort of adjunctive, we have excluded. It is only those identified cases we have taken. Group A with this year MMC and Group B without MMC, and all are done by me. So why this is not coming? No. I don't understand why it is not coming. Can you tell me? Because it is loaded fully.
It's in video, sir?
Yes, it's a video. It is loaded there.
Wait a moment, sir.
Because that's the main thing, no? Anyway, if it is not coming, it's a standard this year. As I said, my landmark is always anterior lacrimal crest. I give the incision there because there is very minimal chance of encountering with any major vessel. Then, okay, thank you. It gives a very good direct exposure of the surgical site. Then I crack the suture and inject some amount of lignocaine with adrenaline. It causes an extreme, a very nice decongestion, as well as it pushes the mucosa away from the bone. That gives a very good help in punching. And then I do the punching with different punches to make the ostium, as I said, 14 by 10 millimeter or so. And when I complete, I usually curate the ostium margin thoroughly, as I am showing here, thoroughly to reduce any osteophytic activity. And then I make the flaps. Here I am showing a anterior flap only. I make anterior flap mostly. In some cases, I make double flaps. And when I cut the posterior flap, I cut it crescentically so that it gives a round of anastomosis. And similarly, we create the lacrimal mucosal flaps. Posterior part is cut up to the neck so that we do not have any redundant tissue, so avoid any recurrent dacrocystitis. And then I soak the Merosil sponge with 0.2 milligram percent and rub it over the ostium, underneath the flap, and in the common canalicular area. And then I close it with three sutures, and then I anchor the anterior flap to the undersurface of the medial papillary ligament. Then I close it regularly, and after that, I inject 0.1 ml of that 0.2% mitomycin in the tract and followed by a profuse syringing. Now it is not going again. Yes, PPD. Oh, you went for this. Yes. I have gone through all this. So we have taken confidence interval at 95% and taken null hypothesis, alternate hypothesis 1 and 2. All the cases were followed up for minimum for 100 days. And out of 350 cases in group A where we use mitomycin, 339 was the success, and out of 75, 65, making it 96.85% versus 86.66%. So we accept the alternate hypothesis 1, which says that mitomycin improves the scenario. and it is statistically significant also. In certain patients, we had an endoscopic examination in 165% in group A and 55% in group B, and size reduction of the ostium at the end of 100 days was 47.8% versus 74.4%, which is also statistically important. And again, the granulation tissue formation was found in 0.86% in group A and 13.33% in group B, which is also statistically significant. So don't let the situation confuse you like this traffic light, where you are to stop, where you are to go, you don't you get confused. Here it's very simple: use mitomycin and get a better success rate. Thank you so much. And I'm sorry that I couldn't sing.
Thank you, Dr. Biraj Goswami, for your elaborate presentation. May I call Dr. Jatinder Singh Bhalla?
Sure. Yeah, good afternoon, everybody. I think this is the last session of such a successful conference. I'm grateful to organizing local organizing committee as well as the chairman scientific committee for giving me this opportunity. I'm going to talk on how we can decrease the infection rate in our intraocular surgeries. The incidence of endophthalmitis, which used to be 0.08% in 90s, suddenly surged to 0.26% in the years between 2000 to 2003. And despite this was despite evidence advances in the medical technologies and treatment, and the causes were change in techniques to clear corneal incision, aging population. So there is a need for protective antibiotics to combat this rise. And it has been published in JCRS that there is an intraoperative contamination of the aqueous humor even in uneventful cataract surgery to the tune of 5 to 43%. And this was done in by studies where there was trypan blue stained conjunctival fluid in the fornix, and it was found that if there is a hypotony postoperatively, this fluid, trypan blue stained fluid, can be sucked into the anterior chamber, and so we can understand how this contamination can occur. And the most common sources of infection are the lids, adnexa, and the respiratory flora. And according to organisms isolated from the vitreous in cases of postoperative endophthalmitis has been shown to be genetically identical to those recovered in the ocular adnexa or the nose. And the surgeon, the problem factors can be not use of povidone iodine, use of lidocaine jelly, vitreous loss, wound leak, increased intraoperative times, and also the material of haptics, particularly hydrophilic ones, and simultaneously bilateral cataract surgery. So chemoprophylaxis to prevent bacterial endophthalmitis can be done either by topical antibiotics. Some people use 1 to 3 days postoperatively or on the day of the surgery for 1 hour preoperatively. Subconjunctival antibiotics, 5% povidone iodine, which is a universal thing, and intracameral antibiotics, which are becoming popular, which are popular in Europe and also in our country now. See, povidone iodine reduces the conjunctival flora by 91% for conjunctival forming colony forming units and 51% for species. And there is a level 2 evidence that povidone iodine helps prevent post-operative infection. So for ocular surface decontamination, use antiseptic like povidone iodine, and for ocular protection, we use antibiotics with favorable pharmacodynamic properties. So perioperative antibiotics have been a common mainstay of post-op endophthalmitis prophylaxis, and it is the route of antibiotic delivery which is critical to determine its efficacy. Now I'll give you some figures which will justify my thesis that preoperative antibiotic eye drops are not effective in reducing the contamination of the anterior chamber. And subconjunctival antibiotic injection is now abundant for pharmacokinetic reason. Systemic antibiotic prophylaxis is reserved only for high-risk cases. So antibiotic supplementation of the infusion fluid fails to achieve the desired decrease in contamination of the anterior chamber. It's only intracameral injection of broad-spectrum antibiotic at the end of the surgery which achieves our goal. Why? Because topical antibiotics started several days before the surgery. You can see it achieves, can I have pointer please? Which achieves a aqueous humor concentration of around 2 microgram per ml. Started on the day of surgery, less than 2 microgram per ml. With combined regime preoperatively and several days before and on the day of the surgery, again 2 microgram per ml. But if you give intracameral injection of 250 microgram, you achieve
close to 1,000 microgram per ml of the aqueous humor concentration. This is a famous study done ESCRS multi-center trial in 2007 by late Peter Barry on about 16,000 patients. And there they showed that the intracameral injection of cefuroxime decreased the risk of endophthalmitis by a figure of 4.92. Similar results were attained by some more studies. ESCRS study had 5 eyes blinded from streptococcal infection, none of which had received intracameral injection. Shortstein published a study in 2012, JCRS, and he had 3 eyes blinded from streptococcal species, none of which had received intracameral injection. All these 5 eyes and 3 eyes had received post-operative antibiotic drops and no intracameral injections. Spanish group, Singapore study, Swedish study, all also emphasize the use of intracameral antibiotics because they significantly reduce the risk of endophthalmitis. There was a study, the first study, large-scale comparative US study, because in the US it is an off-label use of intracameral antibiotic, and they published a study where they found a significant decrease in post-op endophthalmitis rates with the use of intracameral cefuroxime. It was a 5-year study. The first 2 years of this study showed a 2.2-fold decline, and the next 2 years showed a 10-fold decline in the rate of endoff. So there is a change in practice pattern in Europe and US. After the publication of ESCRS study, ESCRS 2012 survey, ASCRS 2014 online survey, 2011 American Academy Preferred Practice Guidelines, 2011 ASCRS Cataract Clinical Committee White Paper, and 2013 ASCRS Guidelines, all are now recommending use of intracameral antibiotics. So once we have decided that intracameral antibiotics are effective, let us decide which antibiotics should be used, because there is no strong evidence nor consensus. These are the various antibiotics which can be used for ocular infections, but the main reservation is that indiscriminate use of antibiotics might increase antibiotic resistance. I'll answer how this can be prevented. There is a concept of minimum inhibitory concentration, minimum bactericidal concentration, and a new concept of mutant preventive concentration. If we give antibiotic in the dose of mutant preventive concentration, you can prevent the mutations leading to the antibiotic resistance. How this is done? It has been found that about 4 to 5 times the minimum inhibitory concentration is bactericidal concentration, and 10 times the minimum inhibitory concentration is mutant preventive concentration. I'll come to this point later on. These are the various antibiotics which can be used for intracameral use: cefuroxime, vancomycin, and moxifloxacin. According to EVS study, 94% of culture-positive endophthalmitis cases is because of gram-positive bacteria, of which 70% is because of staph epidermidis, and 10% is staph aureus. Cefuroxime was the first antibiotic to be used, but since there was no commercially available preparation before Aprocam use, there were dilution errors. There were problems like lack of approved intracameral commercial preparation, kitchen sink pharmacy approach, dilution errors leading to toxic anterior segment syndrome, and increased incidence of gram-negative endophthalmitis. Vancomycin is bacterial bactericidal antibiotic, and it is reserved for serious gram-positive cocci infection. It is active against wide range of bacteria. But there are reservations to use of vancomycin, because this is the antibiotic we use for intravitreal injections in endophthalmitis. And there are 22 case reports of hemorrhagic occlusive retinal vasculitis, which is a visually devastating condition. Moxifloxacin inhibits topoisomerase 2 and 4, and there is improved spectrum of coverage both against gram-positive, gram-negative anaerobes, and also against atypical mycobacteria. And see, if we inject 0.1 cc of 5% 0.5% solution, we achieve a concentration of 952 microgram per ml, and the MIC is just 3 microgram per ml. So we need to achieve for mutant preventive concentration about 10 times, that is 30 microgram, whereas we are injecting more than 300 microgram per ml. Why? Because of half-life. Actual half-life is 2 hours, and moxifloxacin at the level which we have injected maintains aqueous concentration more than MIC for 5 hours and more than MPC for 3 hours. And by that time, the wound almost heals. So that is the reason we should inject this concentration. There are other ways. Espiritu injects, of Philippines, inject 0.1 cc undiluted, whereas Steve Arshinoff injects 3 parts of Vigamox plus 7 parts of Belensol solution, and Matsura of Japan use high dilution, 10-fold dilution, and he replaces the whole volume of the anterior chamber. Advantages of MOXIE are that it is easy to prepare, simple dilution, yellow color makes it easily identifiable, isotonic, no corneal endothelial toxicity, and has the lowest MIC. There is no adverse reaction, no TAS, no hemorrhagic occlusive retinal vasculitis, higher potency, improved spectrum, delayed antibiotic resistance, better tissue penetration, and there is decreased susceptibility. So this is very important. Even if infection occurs, it will be due to MOXIE resistance TAF, which is sensitive to the standard protocol of intravitreal vancomycin. But if infection occurs due to after intracameral cefuroxime, it is due to gram-negative enterobacter, against which we have no answer. So newer innovations with MOXIE have come. There are publications of moxifloxacin, diluted moxifloxacin, pre-soaked hydrophilic acrylic IOL, in which the concentration lasts for more than 10 hours. Then hydration of incision with diluted moxifloxacin instead of balanced solution, as advocated by Steve Arshinoff. Although EVA study indicates that endophthalmitis can be treated and cured, but visual outcome is after treatment is suboptimal, and the best treatment is not treatment. Best treatment is prophylaxis, and at present, best prophylaxis is by intracameral moxifloxacin. See, the number of cataract surgery performed in US was 3.6 million. In India, it was about 6.3 million. Globally, it was 20 million. So it is the largest surgery performed in the world. So we need to guarantee the 100% efficacy and safety of the surgery. And right now we are close to achieving this target only by giving intracameral antibiotics. So indications are, if you still have reservation, it should be given in, according to me, should be given in all patients undergoing cataract surgery. But if you have reservation, the absolute ones are one-eyed patients, diabetes, immunocompromised, PCR, simultaneous bilateral cataract surgery, and if your cataract surgery endophthalmitis rate is more than 2 per 1,000 patients.
Study, will you Indian please studies. Sum up?
Yeah, I'll sum up, sir. Last few seconds. There are Indian studies at Arvind Eye Hospital and at LVP, which have also advocated the use of intracameral antibiotics. So use of safe and effective intracameral antibiotics should permit us to stay one step ahead of the bacteria that threaten our patients' vision. Although this idea is taking some long time before being accepted, but time has now come to shed your inhibition and start the use of intracameral moxifloxacin, which is backed by peer-reviewed published scientific literature. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Any question from the audience? Any question?
Thank you, Dr. Bhalla. If given the choice of cefuroxime and moxifloxacin, which one will you use and why?
Moxifloxacin, sir. See, cefuroxime, I told you, one, there is still dilution errors can occur leading to TAS.
It is commercially available by...
It is commercially available. But second one, more important thing is there are more chances of TAS with this compared to this. It is not, and the isotonicity and the pH of moxifloxacin is there, whereas this is not isotonic. This is slightly hypertonic compared to the normal this thing, tonicity of the aqueous humor. Then if the main important point is that if endophthalmitis occur even after giving intracameral cefuroxime, it is due to enterobacter, against which we have no antibiotic having sensitivity to that. But if it occurs after this thing, moxifloxacin, then we can still treat it by intravitreal vancomycin. So that is the main thing.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Now I call Dr. Chutalia. Manilal Chutalia, he comes from the Gujarat, and it is said he is the most humorous person in ophthalmology in India. So let's hear him.
So you have presentation here?
Yeah. This is a humerus or vitreous humerus?
Wait a moment, sir. I will check.
Yes, sir.
Your good name, sir?
Yeah, I was nine. M.O. Chotalia. Yeah. M.O. Chotalia. Last.
It is humerus or vitreous humerus?
Let us see. Thanks for your kind words, dear Vipin. And first of all, I would like to thank Dr. Lalit Verma, the scientific committee chairman, and the local organizing committee, as well as the chairpersons, to give me the opportunity to be here amongst you all, esteemed audience, for attempting and to make you laugh. This is an attempt to make humorous facts in this presentation as sticky as vitreous humor, so as to remain stuck to the subject related to the ophthalmology and give even and after effect to make you laugh later on. Some of you might have read my jokes in Humor in Ophthalmology or published earlier, or might have heard few ones in this presentation, like Vipin. I request them to remember just like page 17 or so on, and joke number 3, and then to laugh for boosting my attempt. Disclaimer, characters, incidences in this presentation are partly imaginary, few coincidental resemblances are intentionally designed and are not accidental. I will be solely responsible for hurting or for entertaining anybody in the house. I have divided in 3 categories. Humor in ophthalmology is divided into the following headings: humor in ophthalmologist's office, humor related to ophthalmologist outside his office, and humor related to ophthalmology. 3 decades ago, I was surprised to hear that Dr. P.N. Nagpal slapped a patient, when we all know that our respected sir never loses his temper. When I asked the sir about the event, he clarified he had no choice than slapping him when the patient denied reading the vision chart even after changing multiple lenses in the trial frame and uttering at last that he was illiterate. Furthermore, the patient clarified that he registered himself for eye checkup only after hearing someone reading the board outside the office, ₹100 mein padho, consulting fee ₹100. So patient thought that isme kya problem hai, why not to try, agar rupiye mein padhna sikhte ho. A lady enters the ophthalmologist's office threatening him for a shoe as her husband, who was operated by him, or uneventful phaco and was not looking at her. So she thought that it was a failed surgery. Doctor then, after looking towards her, said, "This is the proof that I have operated him successfully." A telephone rings at the midnight at an ophthalmologist's home. When he receives the phone, he listens to a lady urging for an urgent appointment of her 22-year-old daughter, who was a high myope, who had denied the spectacles for the cosmetic purpose, contact lenses for cumbersome handling, and LASIK due to fear before few months. Doctor asked to come to his office next day morning at 10 a.m. But still she insisted that doctor to listen her, stating that her daughter was who just got married a couple of weeks ago and had gone for honeymoon and returned just now with the groom who has been changed. One person was transferred to Junagadh, my native place. He has some problem in eye, so he asked his local colleague about the best ophthalmologist in the town. The local colleague told that Dr. Chotalia is the best ophthalmologist because he has saved my eye once. The guy asked how. The local colleague replied, "Few years back, I had some pain in my eye. I consulted senior most Dr. Kazi, who gave treatment for 3 days, but I was not cured. Then we consulted Dr. Abhay Vasavada, who told that it was corneal ulcer, which will get healed within few weeks. But as Dr. Vasavada was visiting every fortnight from Ahmedabad, the regular frequent follow-up was not possible. So family members decided to consult Dr. Chotalia, that is myself. We went to his clinic and found that he had gone to attend national conference and my eye was saved." Mr. Chatterjee and Mr. Bhattacharya were neighbors, not only in their residence but also in their shops. Mr. Chatterjee was very high myope. One day he lost his glasses in the shop and he became tense, thinking how to reach home. Then he decided to drive his car so as to follow the car of Mr. Bhattacharya when he would leave for home. He was following the Mr. Bhattacharya safely for some time. Suddenly he crashed his car with neighbor's car and came out shouting at neighbor, "You should have shown parking light at least." Mr. Bhattacharya told, "Whom should I show parking light in my own garage? An ophthalmologist can make some people neighbors envy and disclose the owner's pride. A Surdas, blind person, enters neighbor's house and with a box of sweets in his hands and shouts, "Babiji, have sweets." The lady taking bath in bathroom thought that Surdas can't see, so she entered the room straightway from bathroom. She asked him for the cause of distribution of sweets. Surdas happily told, "My eyes have become all right now and I can see now." There is humorous conclusion, funny inclusion, and realistic exclusion. I have defined that an ophthalmologist is a learned person who can see in the eyes of a beautiful lady deeply, even by staring, keeping the other eye closed, or even by touching without objection, and that too with rewards in form of few bucks as fees. Who deals with the organ having one of the most sensitive area, that is cornea. As a result of this property, if something falls in the eye,
it is a problem. And if the eye falls on somebody, it also creates a problem. But ophthalmologist will never think of becoming a gynecologist, keeping in mind that he can be honored in public for his great work by mounting his photograph amidst the eyes model. But he can be envied even by a gynecologist who receives a phone from a lady asking him if she has forgotten her underwear at his office. And when not found, she exclaimed in the phone that she might have forgotten at ophthalmologist's office. Better late than never. Always remember to say all is well during all the activities. Do not hesitate to get surrender whenever you required. And say janapana tushi great ho, tofa kubul karo. I have written in Gujarati, meaning by that if you remain busy all throughout performing the feko only, you will be missing many good moments of life. So if laughter is accompanied with your activities, you will never lose neither your temperament nor you will be panic. So, and there will be a plenty of pleasure with you. Moralized summary, never think hard about past, it brings tears. Don't think more about future, it brings fears. Think more about plenty of humors, live in present, then no tears, no fears, and have must life, which brings cheers. Thank you for patient hearing.
Very nice presentation. Anybody else? Any more speakers? Let me know your name.
Sir, Dr. Ritu. I'm senior resident from RML Hospital.
Oh, you're Dr. Ritu Kumari.
You have presentation?
Yeah.
You're from Delhi, Ramana Loya.
Yeah.
Fruit syphilitic. Like I had given you some.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. I'll be talking about acute syphilitic posterior placoid chorioretinitis. So first, I want to present a relevant case. So this 38-year-old female presented to us with pain, redness, and blurring of vision in the left eye, followed by similar complaint in the right eye since 1.5 months. And it was associated with photophobia and floater. She was already on antiretroviral therapy for HIV since 2 months. So other history was not significant. So coming on to relevant ocular examination, visual acuity was 1/60 with PR accurate in right eye, and it was PL positive and PR accurate in left eye. Pupil was sluggishly reacting in both the eyes, and in anterior chamber, 1+ cell and flare present in the right eye, and 3+ cell and flare present in the left eye. Pigments were noticed on anterior lens surface and IOP was within normal limit. On posterior segment examination, we noticed that there is this yellowish placoid lesion along the inferotemporal quadrant, and it was involving the whole inferotemporal quadrant as well as the disc edema was present. But overlying vitreous was clear in the right eye. In left eye, we noticed grade 3 vitritis, and we noticed a similar yellowish placoid lesion in the superotemporal quadrant. And on autofluorescence imaging, this lesion was hyperautofluorescence. And in right eye, B scan was within normal limit. In left eye, we noticed vitritis and PVD was present. So we made a presumptive diagnosis of right eye acute posterior placoid chorioretinitis with anterior uveitis and left eye panuveitis. And we investigated our patient along the line of uveitis, and we found all the investigation with CBC was within normal limit, and all the immunological marker are also normal. And in infectious profile, we found that VDRL titer was positive and TPHA was also positive. HIV was reactive and CD4 count was 198 cell. All other infectious profile was within normal limit. So for management, as she was already on antiretroviral therapy, so to cover the syphilitic component, we added the injection benzathine penicillin 2.5 million international unit IM weekly for 3 weeks. And to cover the anterior uveitis component, we added eye drop Predfort and eye drop Homide. But not much improvement noticed clinically and symptomatically. So we further studied about our case, and in Harrison, it's given that all cases of syphilitic uveitis CSF should be done. CSF examination should be done, and we did for our patient, and CSF analysis came to be VDRL positive. So the stage of syphilis had changed and it became the tertiary syphilis, that is neurosyphilis. Standard care for this neurosyphilis is injection aqueous penicillin, but as it was not available in our hospital, so alternative was injection ceftriaxone 1 gram IV BD for 2 weeks. And on follow-up visit, we noticed improvement clinically as well as symptomatically. On her last follow-up visit, at 1 month, we noticed that in right eye, the lesion has completely resolved, and in left eye, the vitritis has decreased. And vision we recovered is 6/12 in right eye from 1/60, and in left eye, it was 6/60 from PL positive. And clinically, the picture also improved. So about discussion, first of all about syphilis, acquired syphilis is caused by spirochete treponema pallidum, and it mainly affects the skin, heart and blood vessel, central nervous system and eye. Ocular manifestation are typically associated with neurosyphilis, and uveitis is most common sign. And syphilis should always be a differential in case of unexplained ocular inflammation. Syphilis usually present with diverse various inflammatory presentations such as iritis, chorioretinitis, vitritis, panuveitis, retinitis, episcleritis, scleritis, but this acute syphilitic posterior placoid chorioretinitis is an uncommon and rare ocular manifestation of syphilis, which is usually associated with HIV. In pathogenesis, it is thought to be result of inflammatory reaction at the level of choriocapillaries, RPE, and retinal photoreceptor complex, and is usually accompanied by variable amount of vitritis and may be associated with superficial hemorrhage, retinal vasculitis, disc edema, and exudative RD. It has a characteristic fundus and angiographic picture. In fundus, the yellowish placoid lesion we notice are along the juxtapapillary location, and it's mainly in the posterior and mid-periphery of the fundus. And along with placoid lesion, which are usually the outer retinal lesion, we also notice focal yellow deep retinal lesion, which is similar to drusen. And on FFA, it's revealed early hypofluorescence and late staining of the lesion. That early hypofluorescence is termed as leopard spot hypofluorescence. This lesion is usually hyperautofluorescence, and if we do OCT through the lesion, we notice the loss of IS-OS junction and OSRP band with prominent nodular elevation of RP. It's usually seen in immunocompromised patient, but uncommonly may occur in immunocompetent also. So in any syphilitic patient, HIV should be done. And if syphilis is associated with HIV, the neurosyphilis may occur due to the immune status. Treatment is basically treating for both neurosyphilis and HIV co-infection. Treatment for neurosyphilis is aqueous penicillin, and we should avoid use of any intraocular corticosteroid in eyes with syphilitic uveitis. So the learning point from the discussion and case is that the acute syphilitic posterior placoid is an uncommon but clinically and angiographically distinct manifestation of ocular syphilis, which is usually seen in immunocompromised, and all patients with ASPPC should be tested for both neurosyphilis and HIV. Lumbar puncture with CSF examination is warranted in every case of syphilitic uveitis, as the good visual recovery typically followed completion of appropriate antibiotic therapy. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your nice presentation. Is there any question? No. Anybody else? Dr. Smita. Oh.
Come to the left side, please, ma'am.
Stravitz and surgery.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'll be talking about the spectrum of complications in strabismus surgery. So complications will occur if we perform surgery in a sufficient number of cases. We can get complications either because of unacceptable results which are related to surgery or a new problem related to surgery. We can also get problems which are unrelated to the strabismus surgery. A successful surgery is one where we get minimal post-op discomfort, no scarring, normal palpable fissures, normal version ductions, orthotropia, and normal visual acuity and stereo acuity. However, some results may be acceptable which have small under and over correction, minimal DVT, slight incompetence, mild conjunctival redness, diplopia only in extreme cases, and mild Brown syndrome. We do get transient post-operative conditions like a transient suture reaction, subconjunctival hemorrhage, lid edema, corneal abrasions, Dellen, and barely perceptible lid fissures anomaly, which may also be acceptable early post-operatively. But what is not acceptable is diplopia. If it occurs immediately post-operatively, then we can either patch the eye. If it persists, we can use a Fresnel prism, or we can ground in prisms in the spectacles. But if it doesn't completely relieve, then we have to operate after 3 months. So this is a picture of a Fresnel prism which can be used to prevent diplopia. There can also be loss of vision if during surgery the needle, the suture needle goes a little deep in the sclera. It can lead to retinal detachment, vitreous hemorrhage, endophthalmitis, and even hyphema. Post-operative nausea and vomiting occurs if there is traction on the extraocular muscles. So if we withhold the pre-operative narcotics, nausea and vomiting will be less. And if we use propofol and midazolam, we can prevent post-op nausea vomiting. There can be an acute allergic suture reaction, which mostly starts 10 to 14 days post-operatively, and it's mostly because of disintegration of catgut. However, this is self-limiting, but we can use topical steroids and reduce the amount of suture reaction. The reaction to absorbable sutures can sometimes lead to a chronic suture granuloma and, ultimately lead to a suture abscess. This can be prevented by topical and oral antibiotics. Subconjunctival cysts are small segments of conjunctival epithelium which are buried at the time of closure. So these are small 2 to 3 millimeters diameter filled clear fluid, and if they persist, they have to be excised properly. Sometimes while closing the conjunctiva, the tenons is captured in the wound, which leads to a tenon cyst. And if it persists, this has to be excised and the conjunctiva has to be properly sutured. A Dellen can occur if a limbal incision is used and the conjunctiva is not closed properly. So a smooth closure of the conjunctiva and proper lubrication and patching for about 1 to 2 days post-operatively can help heal the Dellen. Resection of the superior and inferior rectus can lead to narrowing of the palpebral fissure, and recession can lead to widening of palpebral fissures. Scleral perforation can occur at the site of muscle attachment, and it may lead to retinal hemorrhages and vitreous hemorrhage. However, if we engage only the 2.2 mm of depth and make a nice 1.5 mm tunnel in the sclera, then we can avoid scleral perforation. A muscle can be lost intraoperatively, or even it can slip gradually over time. So the sutures have to be placed about 1.5 mm long into the sclera. Infections can range from conjunctivitis to endophthalmitis, but this is not a very common complication, and this can be prevented by using oral antibiotics. Anterior segment ischemia can occur in muscle transposition procedures, and even if you operate more than 2 recti. This was a patient which we operated for traumatic 6 nerve palsy. Post-operatively, he had low visual acuity of 6/12 and a corneal edema with DM folds. We started him on topical antibiotics and steroid along with oral antibiotics. And after 1 week, post-operatively, the patient was normal. So under and overcorrection can also occur after strabismus surgery. If the patient is not corrected within 10 prism diopters, we feel that either the patient is over or undercorrected, and the patient has to be treated like a new patient according to Cooper's dictum. But the surgery has to be repeated only after 3 months. So this was a patient we had the following day after surgery and looked exactly the same. But after 2 weeks, the patient achieved orthotropia. So in such a case, we do not need to repeat the surgery. So a mistake is only a mistake if you don't learn something from it. So we should all learn from our mistakes. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your nice presentation. Is there any question from the audience? Audience. So let's end this session. Word absent. No.